So, last week we've looked into quite a few things. And we've explained from the last couple of weeks, so we've explained something very important. And it says that in order for us to lay the foundation down, the one who has to lay the foundation is our Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ, He is the foundation by excellence. He is the foundation, He is the Word of God, and everything that we do it by the Word of God. So Jesus is the foundation. Jesus Christ is the foundation, He is the one, the beginning of everything, and is at the end of everything. So, we've explained a few things that has happened in our lives. If we want to look, we're based on a text on the book of Matthew, chapter 16, verse 13. Matthew 16, 13. And about what is our relationship with Christ. And when we look into our relationship with Christ, and from what Peter have said, there must be an encounter. We must encounter the Lord. We must encounter God in everything that we do. And in order for the encounter to take place, we have resumed it. There are four steps which need to be there. The first step is confrontation. The second step is revelation, acknowledgement, and public confession. Confrontation means we need to meet Jesus face to face. We cannot live our life just as simple as we must meet Jesus Christ face to face. That is really, really important for us. Because if we do not meet Jesus, we cannot actually have an encounter. The Bible explains to us in the book of John, chapter 10, that Jesus is the door by which we enter into the relationship with the Father. He is the key which opens the door and is the one who brings His word, who brings us into the relationship with the Lord, with God. And the second thing is revelation. And the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ is not something that we acquire by our own understanding. It's not something that we acquire because we go to church every day. It's not something that we acquire simply because we sit at home. But these revelations comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one who brings us the revelation of who God is. And once we have these revelations, we have a choice we have to make. That choice is either we acknowledge Him as being the Son of God, or simply we don't. We should know Jesus Christ, acknowledge Him not being the son of a carpenter, not being a master, but being our Lord and Savior. And the fourth thing, we need also to publicly confess that. And when we look into the building of the foundations, the key thing is that we must be able to prepare the ground where the foundation shall be laid on. Because you cannot lay a foundation on just on the grass. And from the book of Luke chapter 6, verse 46 to 49, the Bible explained to us that there is a need. We need to dig deep before we can lay the foundation down. And all of these came to one thing and one thing only. It is our relationship to the Word of God. Because Jesus Christ is the revealed Word of God. What's the Bible is the written Word of God. Amen. So we finish by saying that knowing the Word is only through the Word, keeping the Word, doing the Word, that is the only way for us to lay down the foundation. Amen. So this is basically conclude our foundations as our personal foundation as Christians. But we need to understand something also very important.
that we cannot be a Christian on our own, because the Bible calls us to a church. Church, it means called out, from the Greek word ecclesia. So we've been called out. We've been put together aside. And together, we are bricks on this big edifice, which is the body of Christ. So we need now, we'll be looking at now, laying down the doctrinal foundation. This is a very important and very key thing in our Christian life. We cannot do anything as Christians if we do not understand what is the doctrine of Jesus. What is our doctrine as Christians? So we'll be focusing now on laying down the doctrinal foundations of the church. Let's open our Bible, the book of Hebrews chapter 6. We are going to read from verse 1 to verse 5. Let me get that. Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 to 3. The Bible says, therefore, leaving the principles of doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works, of faith toward God, of doctrine of baptism, verse, and of laying of hands, and of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. And this will we do if God permits. Amen. So here the Bible says that it mentions six things which are part of the foundation of the doctrine of Christ. And these things are fundamental things for us to understand exactly what is required for us. And today, many churches start to shy away from the word doctrine. Many people call it religion, but let me tell you something, the Bible calls it doctrine. So it is doctrine. So whatever man calls it so that they can actually be pleasant to their ears, that is for themselves to judge. But the Bible speaks and makes a big emphasis when it comes to the doctrine. Doctrine is a very key, and you can see that in a lot of writing of Paul. Bible say Paul mentioned usually the word doctrine used most of the time, because we need to understand exactly what as a Christian we are called to do. And also when we're looking at these texts, something also really important, really apparent, is actually jumped onto us. He said that not laying again the foundations. Because you need to understand something. A foundation of a building is something that you can only lay down once. You can't lay a foundation twice. You can change the roof, you can change the walls, you can change the paint of your car, of your house, but you cannot change the foundation. The foundation remains as it is. So that's why it is really important for us to make sure that the foundation is built correctly. And I want also to call up on your attention on verse 3. And verse 3, what does the Bible say in verse 3? He said, and this will we do if God permits. Why will God not permit us? Why will God not allow us to be able to do this and that? Just simply that, because when you are building, a house, when you start constructing in any serious country, the government will constantly send people to come and check how every step of the house is being built. And usually you see that they spend actually a lot of time into how the foundation of a house is being built. So if the government has a problem with the way you lay down the foundation of your house or either building, it will not allow that work to continue until that has been changed. Amen. Do we all agree? And that is also the same with God. We can be zealous for God. We can be willing to serve God. We can be willing to run for God. We can be willing to give our body for to burn. But what God does is He will come and check the foundations of our faith. God will check the our personal foundation and to see if the foundation is built properly. If the foundation is built the way that it should be built so that it can actually be used. If the foundation is not built as expected, then the Lord will not allow that work to be carried out. Amen. That's why today we have many ministries which has been aborted. We have many people who have started with a lot of zeal, but their works of the Lord have stopped on the way. Simply because when the Lord looks at the foundation of it, this building cannot stand. And when the foundation is not good, let me tell you something, you are simply putting your life at risk because you are into a wobbling building. And that is very dangerous. Amen.
Amen.
So if God permits, so we have to make sure. We must get the go-ahead from the Lord. When God checks our foundation, when God checks our inner person, when God checks on what is it based our faith, it must be based on the truth. It must be based on the revelation of Christ. It must not be based on what our church says. It mustn't be based on what our pastor says. It mustn't be based on what your fathers taught you. But it must be based on, simply on the word of God and the revelation of Jesus Christ, who is the Son of God. Amen. And if we cannot actually do that, if we cannot actually be able to stand and say, what is this for? Then I think we are actually in a big trouble. So, the Bible lists six major things which is a fundamental to the foundation of the church or to the doctrine of Christ. The first one the Bible says it is repentance from dead works, faith toward God, doctrine of baptism, laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. So we have six things. We have six major topics that as Christians we need to master. As Christians, as a church, we need to understand. These six things are fundamental. And if you look at it closely, it is all usually on based on these six things that many churches have actually went sideways, simply because they couldn't just agree on what the Bible teaches concerning these six things. So today, we'll be looking at into the first one, which is repentance. The Bible says here that repentance from dead works. What is dead works? What do we call that dead works? And when I tried to check in dictionaries, from my previous understanding of dead works, it's simply that every work would lead you to death. But the reality is that is not actually quite correct. Dead works is not the works which lead you to death. But my definition, what I've come to understand from what the Lord has taught me through multiple teachings, is that dead works is anything which is not done in faith. Anything that we do in faith, which we do not in faith, it's called dead works according to the Bible. Because the Bible explains to us that faith is the one who gives life. It's the faith in Christ which gives us life. So dead works is anything which is not done in faith. So, what is repentance? And let us look at it closely into the word to repentance. When we look at it today, today where of the world where things happen, they have resumed repentance to an emotion. Repentance is not an emotion. Repentance is an act of the will. Repentance is an act of the will. It's not an emotion. It's not something that we can simply just we sit down and we'll see, feel emotion about it. And many people today in the church, many people, many Christians wherever they are, so we are having a problem where they think that repentance is emotional. So somebody will go into the church, he will be touched by the message, and he will start to be crying. He will start to be crying, "Oh Lord, I repent, I repent, I repent." Why? Because they're being emotional regarding it. And let me tell you something. Emotions can last a day, it can last a week, it can last a month, even the last few years. But you have to understand something. As soon as the juice, the drive of emotion stops, you be going back to where you're coming from. Repentance is not an emotion. Repentance, it is an act of the will. You cannot be emotional when it comes to repentance, but you must be rational. You need to make a decision that I'm willing to repent. And when you're looking at the definition of the repentance in the Bible itself, it is actually what you call to change your mind. The word repentance, which is in the Bible, in the Greek, it means changing your mind. In the Hebrew, it's very simple way that turning around, doing a U-turn, 180 degrees. It means giving your back to your life when you were heading to sin and turn back onto the Lord. That is what repentance have it's all about. It's not an emotion. It's not about me making you feel good. And today, we have many churches, many places where people are kind of manipulating emotions. Why? How do they do that? By probably playing some subtle music when they are preaching, so that it creates a certain atmosphere where people become emotional concerning things, where people start to actually be looking into and feeling in a certain way, and then people are like, "Oh, I feel the presence of the Holy Ghost." That is not what the Bible called for us. What the repentance is, it is as a Christian, you have to make a decision. You have to make a decision to say, "You know what, I'm tired of living this life and I want to change. Lord, help me." Amen. Amen. So can you just tell to your neighbor, repentance is not an emotion, but it is a decision. The act of the will. Amen. So let's quickly looking at into the nature of repentance. Let's look at in the book of Luke. Luke chapter 15. And let's really look closely exactly how does the Bible explain repentance. Luke chapter 15. We'll read from verse 17. And this is actually the parable of the prodigal son. So here, it's what the Bible explained repentance to be like. And it says, and when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. And I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." And he arose, came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, and he has compassion and ran, and fell on his neck and kissed him. This is the Bible, the story tells us about the prodigal son. So this is about the second son of a very wealthy man, who took all the money of his father, his inheritance, went away to live an abominable life. Well, into that life, he has spent all his inheritance. He has spent all his father's money, and he found himself nothing. And he gets to a point where he was not even able to afford a meal. And the only job he could have got and he could get, it was feeding swines or pigs. For a Jew who does not even eat pig, that is a great insult. It is an insult. This is a no. Disrespect to those who raise pigs, because they are lovely animals and I love my bacon too much. But I'm just talking is more in terms of cultural perspective. For the Jew, pigs were the most abominable thing they could have. They were so abominable that they were not even allowed to destroy, because it was an abomination to the Lord. And this is what this young man, who has spent his father's wealth, has found himself to. And look at what the Bible explains to us. The first step into repentance, the first step that we need to think about repentance, number one, it is you need to realize. The Bible said that he came to himself. You need to look deep inside yourself. You need to be looking deep inside yourself if this is the life that you are willing to live. Let me tell you something, Christian. Let me tell you something, brethren. Listen, repentance comes before faith. Today we are only, and many people are interested about faith. We preach about faith. We preach, if you have faith, you can do this. If you have faith, you can move mountains. If you can have faith, God can heal you. But we don't speak about repentance. Let me tell you something. Without repentance, you cannot talk about faith. Because repentance is the key. It is the first block of foundation which has to be laid. If you do not lay the block of repentance, everything else that you build on top of that building will be wobbling, because simply because it's not actually stable. So our life as Christians begins with repentance. So here, for you to repent, the Bible says that you need to come to your senses. You need to come back to yourself. You need to tell yourself, you know what? I cannot continue this. You have to acknowledge what you've done wrong. You need to tell yourself and say, you know what? I have sinned before the Lord. I've done abominable things before the Lord. God, have mercy upon me. God, have mercy upon my life. And that is the key. That is the first and the most important things for us Christians. I'm not here for to send you money. I'm not here to tell you how rich you can be. But it is all begin by repentance. And after you've realized this, after you've come to the place where you understand that, you know what, this is not the life you ought to live. The Bible said to us that the boy made a decision. You need to come to a decision, my brother and sister. You need to come to a decision to your situation. You cannot continue living the life that you are living, expecting that grace can continue to abound in your life. You need to make a decision and say that, you know what, I cannot longer live like this. I have to move on. I have to go back. I have to return to God. Because if I do not return to God, my life, I'm going to perish. And after you made a decision, it is good. But it is better, and it is even more, that you need to carry on that decision to the end. You need to take action for to do what you decide to do in your life. You need to realize, you need to make a decision, and you need also to carry on your decision. There is what also the Bible explains to us, it is false repentance. And I think many Christians fall into this category. Let's look at the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27. And we read verse 3 to 5. Matthew 27, verse 3 to 5. And Judas, which has betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priest and elder, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? Sit down to do that. And he cast down the piece of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. In the King James, it says, repented himself, which is also translated as remorse. this is one thing that many Christians do today. Instead of to be repenting before the Lord, they become remorseful. Simply that they start to carry guiltiness. They start to carry the heaviness of the act that they've committed. And usually, this always leads to death, or this leads to destruction. Because you see that because of this, many people have fallen victim of alcohol. Many people have fallen victim of drugs. Many people have fallen victim of cigarettes. They become addicted because they just want something to remove that heavy heart that they have. Many people have become gluten. It means they've just fallen into the sin of eating normally. And some of them even has fallen into a life of perversion, into sex all the time, or start to prostitute themselves. Simply because they were carrying on they were remorseful. They were not repenting, but remorseful. As Christians, we shouldn't be remorseful, but we should be more repenting before the Lord. And one of the key things, one of the most dangerous things that we need to understand as Christians, the Bible said that we cannot continue living in sin and expect grace to abound. And God hates people who despise His grace. Let's look at an example. Open the Bible, the book of Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. We read from verse 14. And it says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Holiness without sin, no one will see the Lord. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up and troubles you, thereby many be defiled. Bitterness poisons our heart as Christians. Bitterness poisons our hearts and troubles us. And at the same time, it defiles us. So we cannot, we shouldn't allow ourselves to allow bitterness to continue in our life. Let me tell you something very important. When the son have realized his poor conditions, when he made a decision to go back to his father's house, the Bible explains to us something profound happened. He has a speech prepared for him to go and tell his father that I'm no longer able to be called your son, but treat me like a servant. But when he turned to him, the father saw him, the Bible said, the father ran to him, hold him in his arm, kissed him. He did not allow him to fall from the grace or the position of a son, which was into, but to become a servant. He has still kept him as a son. This is the image of God. When we turn away from our sin, when we repent from our ways, the Bible says that God waits for us like a father. And He stands in our way and looked at us. And as He saw us coming from far, He doesn't let us come all the way to Him. But from the time when you decide to make up your way, you made your mind and you make a decision to come back to Him. By the time you make your first step, the Bible says that the Lord runs and hides you. God is not a God who simply just look at us far away and let us go through everything before he can forgive us. The Bible says that if we can only confess our sin, he is ready and just to forgive us our sins and to wash us from every unrighteousness. Because without holiness, we cannot see him. In order for us to be accepted in his presence, we need that holiness. And about verse 16 and continuing in Hebrew, it says, lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau. The Bible compares Esau, Jacob's brother, to a fornicator or a profane person, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. When we despise the grace of God, when we despise or we forsake our position as children of the Most High, the Bible explains to us something very important happens to us. It says that we are as fornicators, profane people. There is no place in the Bible where the Bible recorded Esau as committed fornication. But his act of simply rejecting or despising the grace of God, his birthright, because just of a piece of meat and bread, was good enough for the Lord. And the Bible said he was rejected. He was rejected when the day of inheritance came. So if you still want to hold, you do not want to repent from your bitterness, from your anger, from all root of evil, for all the troubles that is in your heart, let me tell you something. You are simply despising the grace of God. If I explain to you, repentance comes before faith. The message of repentance is a key message for the church to preach. When you look at the book of Matthew, when John started his ministry, Matthew chapter 3, from verse 1, it says, in those days came John the Baptist preaching the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But this he that was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, preparing the way of the Lord, make this path straight. Repentance prepares the ways for God to come in our life. Repentance prepares the way of salvation. Repentance prepares us to the relationship that we have from God. And when Jesus was speaking concerning the same message, when John is gone, Jesus came also. In Mark chapter 1, verse 14 to 15. And it says, now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into the Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. The second thing that the repentance prepares us, it is to believe. So number one, the repentance prepares the ways for the Lord in our life. Number two, repentance prepares us to believe the gospel. We need to believe the gospel. It prepares us to believe the gospel. And also when you're looking at into Luke chapter 24, Luke 24, Luke 24, this is what Jesus has rose from the dead, from verse 46 to 47. And he said, and say unto them, thus it is the wisdom, and thus is beloved as to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day. And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name amongst the nation, beginning at Jerusalem. Repentance prepares us to the remissions of sin. And Jesus says this, he said that this is the message that you have to take to the nations. You have to go and teach the nations that they have to repent. Because you cannot have your sin washed away. You cannot have your sins cleaned unless you decide to repent. Repentance prepares us for receiving the cleaning of our sin. Number four, in the book of Acts chapter 2, verse 37, this is Peter preaching, and he said, now they heard this saying, they will bring in their heart and say unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Today we have a lot of people who are looking into receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. But the Bible makes it clear, there is repentance and there is baptism. And it's only after we baptize in the water, then the next step, it is receiving the Holy Ghost. Baptism, it is a public declaration of our faith before God. So we need, the Bible has not changed. But as the church today, we the church today, have changed. The message of repentance is no longer preached out of pulpits. Baptism is no longer encouraged into the church, but everybody wants to receive a touch of the Holy Spirit. And it is a grace, it is a place of honor, it is a place of humility when one gets to the place and asks God, what should I do for to be saved? And every time when we address this prayer to the Lord, God, he say, will never cast us out. Amen. And then number five, repentance. Number five, Acts chapter 17, verse 30 to 31. And he said, and the time of this ignorance God winked, but now command all men everywhere to repent. The God is appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he had ordained. Wherefore he has given assurance unto all men in that he has raised him from the dead. Repentance also has the key value to prepare us for to meet the judge. We always preach Jesus Christ as being the Savior. But the Bible, when you look at the apostle preaching Jesus Christ, he was always presenting Jesus Christ as being the judge. The reason we speak more about the Savior part of Jesus, not the judge, simply because we are not willing to teach people repentance. We have to repent, or else we will be judged by Jesus. Jesus will judge our act into righteousness. Everything that we do will be tested. Will be tested into righteousness to see if this fulfills the laws of God or it fulfills the laws of men. And the last not least. And Acts chapter 20. Yeah, I should finish in the next few minutes. Acts chapter 20. The next step. So, just to do a quick recap. So, repentance prepares us for, prepares the way for Christ to come into our life. Number two, it prepares us for the remission, for the works of the kingdom. Number three, for the remission of sin. Number four, for baptism and the gift of the Spirit. Number five, it prepares us to meet God as the judge. And also, number six, now Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, verse 20 to 21, it says, "And I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but I've shewed you and have touched the poor publicly from the house of the house, testifying both to the Jew and also to the Greek. Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ." Number six, repentance prepares us for faith. There cannot be faith without repentance. We have to repent before we can receive the gift of faith. And the last but not least, repentance is for everyone. Repentance is for everyone. So we need, all of us have to repent. Now my question to you is this. When you have to look into this, why do people repent and some people do not repent? How come that I know that I should repent, but some people simply do not repent? Because the reason is very simple. Repentance starts with God. It's God who gives us a heart to repent. In the book of Psalm chapter 80, for example, Psalm chapter 80, three times it's been mentioned here concerning repentance. In verse 3, it says, "Turn us again, O God, and cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved." Turn us again, which is also translated in the Hebrew as repent. Repent. Lord, grant us the grace to repent. In verse 7, he says, "Turn us again, O God of hosts, and thy face, and call thy face to shine, and we shall be saved." And in verse 17, verse 19, and it says, "Turn us again, O Lord of hosts, cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved." Repentance starts with God, and it is the grace of God for us to repent. And let me tell you something. There is only one alternative to repentance. There is only one alternative. In the book of Luke chapter 13, verse 1 to 5, the Bible makes it very clear. Luke 13, 1 to 5 makes it clear. The only alternative to repentance, it is to perish. If we do not repent from our dead works, dead works, which is defined as what? As anything that we do which is not done in faith. Which is not done in the faith of God. It means that you can be coming to church if you are praying just by because you've been asked to pray, but you're not praying in faith. It's called dead works. And the Bible calls us to repent from that. So quickly tell your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, let us repent." And we are just going to pray with you. And we are going to seek the grace of God. As the Bible explains to us, repentance starts with God. We are going to pray that the Lord will grant us grace to repent. Examine your life right now. If you have repented from anger, you have repented from bitterness, if you have repented from any dead works, hypocrisy, or lies, all those things that does not honor God. If you can just repent and examine yourself. As even also as a church, let us come before the Lord in humility. Let us come before the Lord in humility and then just ask God for mercy. Because today, as a church, we have failed. Why? Because we're starting to choose the things that we have to teach. Paul said that, I've declared everything publicly. I've not kept anything. But we have stopped preaching concerning repentance. Repentance is the key. Is the fundamental block for to be put for the growth of the building of our church, the building of our life, of our Christian life. So, where you are, can you just stand up right now? Just lift up your voice right now and come in humility before the Lord and say, Lord, grant me the grace of repentance. As an individual, grant me the grace of repentance. And as a church, grant us the grace to repent. Lift up your voice and let us pray. In Jesus' mighty name.